Macmillan Audio presents The Real Crash, America's Coming Bankruptcy, How to Save Yourself and Your Country, by Peter D. Schiff. Read for you by Oliver Wyman. Introduction. I guess you were right about the crash, Peter. I hear that a lot, in reference to my 2007 book, Crash Proof, where I predicted an economic catastrophe in the United States. Since late 2008, when the housing market had collapsed and major banks went to the brink of failure, whenever people credit me with calling the crash, it pains me to tell them that what they saw in 2008 and 2009 wasn't the crash. That was the tremor before the earthquake. The real crash is still coming. Just as the housing bubble delayed the economic collapse for much of the last decade on the strength of imaginary wealth, today, twin bubbles in the U.S. dollar and treasury bills and bonds are providing a similar prop. But the day will come when the rest of the world stops trusting America's currency and our credit. Then we'll get the real crash. During my run for Senate in 2010, I constantly encountered politicians and journalists who blamed the current economic troubles on capitalism and free markets, arguing that more government was needed. When the bigger crash comes, the attacks on capitalism will become louder, and the proposed government interventions will become even more extreme. This makes sense. Politicians want more power, and they know that crises and panics are the best opportunities to get people to surrender their freedom for the promise of security. That's what Rahm Emanuel meant when he said, after the 2008 election, you never want a serious crisis to go to waste. But the government was a chief architect of the mess that we're in, and every day, government is making it worse. I invest for a living. I look for where other people are making mistakes. I look for companies or commodities that are misvalued by the market, and I study who is investing where. It's glaring that American companies are still not making capital investments. American families, after a brief period of paying down debt and increasing savings, are borrowing more than they're saving. Just as in 2008, we have too much consumption and borrowing and too little production and saving. Since the depths of the economic downturn in early 2009, most of the wealth we've created has, once again, been imaginary. Real estate is still grossly overpriced. Most stocks are still overpriced as valuations are based on earnings and artificially low interest rates, and both are unsustainable. Companies that are hiring are probably making mistakes they will soon regret. The fundamentals of the economy are not sound, not even close. 4 years ago, I said that the disease in the economy is debt-financed consumption, and that the cure would require a recession. But the medicine I prescribed, Americans consuming less and saving more while companies invest for the long term and the government tightens its belt, was deemed too bitter a pill to swallow by the Bush and Obama administrations. Instead, they fed us bailouts and stimulus to blow the bubble back up. This political aversion to austerity has set us up for an even bigger crash. Not only did I predict the recent collapses of the housing bubble and the stock market in Crash Proof, I also predicted the government reaction. I was the original opponent of the 2008 Wall Street bailout because I was opposing it in 2007, a year before the Bush administration even proposed it. In 2006 and 2007, when I made all these predictions, the experts laughed at me. Literally, search for Peter Schiff was right on YouTube and you'll see. I was dubbed Dr. Doom for my dire and ultimately correct predictions. While the laughter and the names never hurt my feelings, this time I have decided that rather than simply predicting doom, I would lay out a comprehensive set of solutions. That's why I wrote this book. My prescription at heart is this. We need to stop bailouts, government spending, government borrowing, and Federal Reserve manipulation of interest rates and debasement of the dollar. We need to reduce government spending so we can offer real tax relief to the productive sectors of our economy. We need to repeal regulations, mandates, and subsidies that create moral hazards, lead to wasteful and inefficient allocation of resources, and artificially drive up the cost of doing business and hiring workers. We need to let wages fall, allow people to pay down debt and start saving, and allow companies to make capital investments so that America can start making things again. And regarding our national debt, there is only one good solution, and it's the one that no politician, debt commission, or TV talking head is proposing. America needs to restructure its debts. We're already bankrupt. It's time we declared it. The USA is insolvent and should enter the sovereign equivalent of Chapter 11 bankruptcy. Then, like a bankrupt company, we can pay off some fraction of our debts to China, to Social Security recipients, and other debt holders, and then reorganize. Nobody wants to hear this news, and politicians certainly don't want to deliver it. But Americans will like it even less when the real crash comes, when unemployment skyrockets, credit dries up, home prices plummet again, or worse, the dollar collapses, wiping out all savings and sending consumer prices into the stratosphere. My proposal is to soften the blow. Instead of a violent crash, my plan would give us a painful but limited recession. In addition to saving us from economic ruin, my plan would have immediate benefits for Americans. Lower taxes and less regulation would mean more freedom and more room for small businesses. Savers would benefit from sound monetary policy and from realistic interest rates. I don't expect policymakers to adopt my plan anytime soon. I think it will take some serious economic pain before politicians are willing to do anything outside of the ordinary. When the situation is ugly, Washington will have to consider the sorts of ideas I prescribe. The unprecedented dangers our economy faces also mean you need to completely change the way you handle your money. Even if you don't think of yourself as an investor, you need to start paying more attention to your wealth because our economic predicament means there will be no easy way to protect your money. Conventional wisdom about investing doesn't work anymore because we are in unconventional times. The Fed will be printing so much money that your dollars could become worthless. Our government is so profligate that your U.S. treasuries could become subprime assets. You need to look to overseas assets and invest with the knowledge that the U.S. of the future will not be anything close to the economic powerhouse it was in the past. But in the long run, my proposals could turn things around. We'd have a firmer foundation for our economy, a constrained government, a better education system, a more sustainable financial sector, and more room for innovation, meaning a more prosperous world. Right now, though, we're in a car out of control speeding down an icy hill. Our politicians pretend they're in control, so we just keep accelerating toward the bottom. We need a grown-up to grab the wheel and steer us into the ditch on the side of the road. That won't be pretty, but it's better to go into the ditch at 80 miles an hour than crash into a brick wall at the bottom of the hill at 120. This audiobook shows the way out of our mess with as little suffering as possible. The proposals are drastic and sound painful, but the alternative is worse. The time for a so-called soft landing has passed. All we can do now is prepare for the crash. If we brace ourselves properly and control the impact, at least we will survive it. Part 1. The Problem. Chapter 1. Where we are and where we are headed. As I stated in the introduction, the real crash I predicted in my first book is still coming. You see, before 2006, I had been predicting an economic catastrophe in the United States, with the burst of the housing bubble being the catalyst. Once that bubble burst and major banks went to the brink of failure, people began crediting me with calling the crash. But what we saw in 2008 and 2009 wasn't the crash. That was the overture. Now we have to sit through the opera. The economic unpleasantness of those days was definitely part of the real crash, but only because of the way our politicians responded, replacing one government-created bubble with another, thus putting our economy at even greater risk. The same bubble machine that fueled the last two boom-bust cycles, the Federal Reserve, is already back in high gear, and we must turn it off. The Fed needs to stop fueling inflation and start sucking dollars back out of the economy. It also needs to let interest rates rise. When the Fed does those two things, Washington's free ride will end. It will no longer be able to borrow at near zero interest. As a result, Congress will have to slash spending, fix our entitlements, and generally shrink government. These are the right things to do today. They were the right things to do 10 years ago. but soon they will become inevitable. We will have no choice. My past books predicted the crash. This book goes a step further and lays out the steps we need to take in order to make this crash as painless as possible and to rebuild in the aftermath. We need to wind down entitlements, eliminate many government functions, and stop playing with the money supply and interest rates. America needs to start making things again, and the government needs to stop taking. As individuals and as a nation, we need to get out of debt. And ultimately, we'll have to face up to the fact that we can't pay off all our debts. The later chapters spell out the solutions, but these first two chapters describe the problem. Our economy today is once again built on imaginary wealth. Like the proverbial house built on sand, it will collapse. When that happens, when America's tab finally comes due, it will probably be as bad or worse than the Great Depression. You'd better be ready for it. From a dot-com bubble to a housing bubble to a government bubble. To understand how bad things are and where we're headed, let's quickly go back a decade or so and retrace the steps that brought us here. Throughout the 1990s, the Federal Reserve injected tons of money into the economy, which fueled a stock bubble focused particularly on dot-com companies. In 2000 and 2001, when the stock market turned down and unemployment started to creep up, that was a correction. Assets that had been overvalued, such as stocks, were returning to a more appropriate price. The dot-com and stock market bubble had misallocated resources, and while investment was fleeing the overvalued sectors, inevitably the economy shrunk and unemployment rose while wealth became more rationally allocated around the economy. Readjustments in the economy involve short-term pain, just as the cure to a sickness often tastes bitter. Short-term pain, however, was unacceptable to the politicians and central bankers in 2000 and 2001. Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan manipulated interest rates lower. This made borrowing cheaper, inspired more businesses to invest, and softened the employment crunch. But the economy wasn't really getting stronger. That is, there weren't more businesses producing things of value. As there were few good business investments, all this cheap capital flowed into housing. As housing values skyrocketed, Americans were getting richer on paper. This made it seem as if things were okay. In other words, Greenspan accomplished his goal of forestalling any significant pain. By the same token, he also kept the economy from healing properly, which would have laid the foundation for a stronger and lasting recovery. When market reality started to bear down on the economy and the housing bubble popped, with the broader credit bubble right behind, the government was running out of things to artificially inflate. So the Fed and the Obama administration decided to pump money desperately into government. I'll explore this how we got here story in more depth in Chapter 2, but for now, I'll make this point. Just as the housing bubble delayed the economic collapse for much of the last decade on the strength of imaginary wealth, the government bubble is propping us up now. The pressure within the bubble will be so great that the Federal Reserve will soon have only two options. A, to finally contract the money supply and let interest rates spike, which will cause immensely more pain than if we had let this happen back in 2002 or 2008, or B, just keep pumping dollars into the economy, causing hyperinflation and all the evils that come with it. The politically easier choice will be the latter, wiping out the dollar through hyperinflation. The grown-up choice will be the former, electing for some painful tightening, which will also entail the federal government admitting that it cannot fulfill all the promises it has made and cannot repay everything it owes. In either case, we'll get the real crash. The national debt. As a professional investor, when I study the American economy today, I see debilitating weaknesses. Most obvious is the debt. As this audiobook was being recorded, the national debt was $17 trillion. That works out to approximately $140,000 per taxpayer. Let's talk a bit about what this means. Whenever the government wants to spend money it doesn't have, it borrows. Our government borrows by selling T-bills and treasury bonds, or treasuries. The buyer gets an IOU, and the government gets cash. So various bondholders, individual investors, U.S. banks, the Chinese government, the Federal Reserve, even parts of the U.S. government, hold in aggregate $17 trillion in IOUs. These bonds and bills come due all the time, and typically, the Treasury pays them off by borrowing again. Every day, the debt grows. First, it grows because it accumulates interest. In 2010, taxpayers paid $414 billion in interest on the national debt, but that wasn't enough to keep the debt from growing. Another reason the debt keeps growing, our government keeps borrowing more in order to spend more. Barack Obama's $800 billion stimulus in 2009.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.